Hello students. Today's our lecture is based on the movements. We can find that there is an enormous increase in the studies on social movements in recent years. In this lecture, we shall analyze two such social movements, the peasant movements and the labor movements in contemporary India. Now, Indian economy basically dependent on agriculture before the independence. India was a poor nation with its traditional ways and methods of farming. Feudal lords had complete mastership over the lands, and after the independence, there was a need to modernize and increase the agriculture production. In the beginning of 1960s, new policies started to introduce to the Indian population under the banner of Green Revolution, which mainly focused on the increase of production. According to the policies, all the agriculture facilities were planned, but it did not give the expected results. These agricultural policies were useful for the rich and the middle class farmers only, and the condition of the poor peasants deteriorated drastically. So, the peasants' movement in the contemporary India may be classified into two categories. Now, the first type of movement is of the poor peasants. Such movements focus on their economic conditions. The agricultural laborers demanded higher wages and better working conditions. The second type of movement is of the more prosperous peasants. These movements are often referred to as new peasant movements or new agrarianism. These movements have arisen in recent years in the Green Revolution areas such as in Western Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, Punjab, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Southwestern Maharashtra. With this basic information, let's understand the origin or the beginning of the peasant day movements. The history of the peasant unrest can be traced back to the first quarter of the 1920s. Many socialists have used various terms for the peasant unrest. For some, the unrest is called as a peasant struggle. For others, it is a peasant uprising. And some others call it as a peasant revolution. And some other socialists simply call it a movement. Whatever may be the term, but the fact is that the independent India has found out a way to struggle against the oppression of peasants. S.L. Doshi and P.C. Jain has mentioned in their book Rural Sociology that the change in the agrarian situation has resulted in a change in the problems. The peasants have more demands. These situations have changed the relation between the landlords and the agricultural laborers. Though this syllabus unit focuses on the independent India, the present topic needs to be studied because they have their origin in the pre-independent India. We are not going to differentiate movements according to the independence of India, but we will discuss some of the very important movements which took birth before independence and forwarded into the independent India. Now, let's have a detailed discussion on some of the important peasant movements. The number one is the most famous, the Champaran Satyagraha. The peasant movement of Champaran was launched in 1917 to 1918. It was a part of the independence movement of India. The movement aimed to create an awakening among the peasantry against the European plants, as these planters exploited the peasants without giving them adequate remuneration for their labor. Even plants used the illegal and inhuman methods of indigo cultivation. In addition to that, the local zamindars also exploited the peasants. The torture of planters and zamindars has reached its highest peak. So, Gandhiji took took initiative and launched the movement. When Gandhiji returned from South Africa, he wanted to practice his non-cooperation and satyagraha in India. That time, the peasants were in a bad condition. The peasants were compelled to grow indigo and forced to devote their best part of land to cultivate crops according to the wish of landlords. Even the peasants were not getting enough wages to survive. And this miserable condition of peasants led Gandhiji to begin his satyagraha. The movement is basically non-violent, but the incident in Chauri Chaura made it violent and Gandhiji became unhappy. A large group of protesters participating in the non-cooperation movement clashed with the police, who opened fire. In retaliation, the demonstrators attacked and set fire to a police station, killing all of its occupants. The incident led to the deaths of 3 civilians and 22 to 23 policemen. But the movement has brought about certain important outcomes. The Champaran Agrarian Act was accepted by the Government General of India on 1st May 1918. The movement also helped in the growth of nationalism. Now, coming on to the next movement is the Kheda peasant struggle. Kheda is situated in the central part of Gujarat and was quite a fertile land for the cultivation of tobacco and cotton crops. The peasantry of Kheda consisted of the pattidars. They were known for their skills in farming. They were also very well educated. The situation became worse when the government increased the tax, which the peasants refused to pay. The government did not give any excuse at that time, when the peasants of Kheda were suffering from a severe famine. As a result of this, the peasantry submitted petitions to the higher authorities of the province, requesting the suspension of the revenue assessment of the year 1919. But the results were negative. When the government refused the demands of the peasants, Gandhiji took initiative and encouraged the peasantry to resort to satyagraha. Gandhiji got help from Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, N.M. Joshi and several other activists in this satyagraha. As a result of this satyagraha, government decided that the rich peasants will pay their land rent and the poor peasants got exemption. This success spread among the other peasants of Gujarat and to the neighboring states too. Now, coming on to the next movement is the Bardoli movement in Gujarat. The year 1925 was very bad for Bardoli Taluka. There was a heavy flood, a severe famine. When such situation occurs, it is obvious that there must be the financial problem. And the same happened with the Bardoli peasants. In addition to that, the government of Bombay Presidency raised the tax rate by 30% without considering the situation of peasants that were starving due to the calamities. A few activists of Gujarat, such as Narhari Parikh and Ravi Shankar Vyas, took leadership with the help of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and had a talk with the village leaders. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel requested the governor to reduce the taxes. But unfortunately, the governor of Bombay rejected this request. He then instructed the farmers of Bardoli to refuse to pay the taxes. Patel divided Bardoli into several zones with the help of few activists and volunteers. They decided not to stop their struggle until the cancellation of all the taxes for the whole year and return all the seized property and lands to their owners. The government decided to crush the revolt. So the government gathered the Pathans from the Northwest India and tax inspectors to take away the properties, which also included cattle. The government started auctioning of this property, but no one from Gujarat or from other parts of India came forward to buy that. As a result of this, the people and the member of the legislative councils of Bombay were very angry at such a bad treatment. The Indian members also resigned from the offices and supported the protest of the peasants. At last, an agreement took place by the initiation of the Parsi member of the Bombay government. Now, according to that, the government agreed to restore the confiscated property and also cancel the whole revenue payment for the year and also cancel the 30% rise of taxes until the next year. In this way, the Bardoli Satyagraha became a grand success. Now, let's come up to the next movement, that is the Mofla Rebellion in Malabar. Now, Moflas were Muslim peasants settled in the Malabar region of Kerala. They had a heterogeneous social and economic background. Few of them were traders and merchants, and the rest of them worked as small agriculturists who were the tenants of big landlords. Now, when Mofla peasant movement started during that time, Malabar was under the British rule. The Mofla tenants agitated against the Hindu and the British government. Their grievances were related to the insecurity of tenure, high rents, renewal of fees, and other unfair exactions of the landowners. As a result of this, a movement started in August 1921. Looking at the major causes behind this movement, we can find that the Mofla peasants and the Hindu landlords were not in a good relationship. There was a gap of religion status between them. Even many times, the Moflas were expelled from their land without any prior notice. And most important factor which caused the Mofla agitation was the Khilafat movement. This movement took place in Malabar and Moflas actively took part in that. At the same time, the British government was weakened because of the First World War, and it was not in a condition to take any military action against the movement. But the leader of the Khilafat movement got arrested and the movement became dull. Many people got killed in the firing of the police, and it resulted in a clash. The government offices were destroyed, records burnt, and the treasury was looted. Soon the rebellion spread everywhere and started destroying the Hindu landlords. The most important aspect of the Mofla peasant movement was the communalization of peasant agitation. In December 1921, the Britishers crushed the rebellion and all the resistance was stopped. Because of the communal interference, the movement faced failure. Another reason was the violence of peasants as a method of rebellion. So no positive outputs were there, and the Mofla rebellion was over with a huge failure. Now let's move towards the next movement, that is the Peasants' Revolt in Telangana. This movement started against the Nizam of Hyderabad. At that time, Reyotwari and Jagirdari were the two prominent land tenure systems prevalent. The Deshmukhs and the Deshpandes were the hereditary tax collectors of the Khalsa villages. The Jagirdars and the Deshmukhs had immense power to torture the peasants. The cultivators were oppressed and exploited by these powerful people. And out of that, a slavery system took birth. Under the system, the tenants who have taken loans from the landlords had to serve the landlords for generations, as the landlords used to maintain records, which shows that the tenants are still in debt to them. In addition to that, the irrigation facilities provided by the Nizam were used by the big farmers only. These are just some of the major reasons behind the Telangana movement. Actually, such other factors were also there, because of which the conditions of the peasants reached its saturation point by 1930s. This dehumanized state forced them to think about rebelling. The Communist Party of India took initiative in this struggle. Apart from the peasant agitation, a parallel paramilitary voluntary force was organized by Qasim Rizvi. The members of this organization were called the Razakars. The organization worked against the peasants. The Indian Army marched into the state of Hyderabad on 13th September 1948. It suppressed the Nizam's army and the Razakars. But unfortunately, many Telangana peasants were killed in the police action. The major achievement of this movement was that it brought together the tenants, the sharecroppers, and the landless laborers for the first time. But all over the Telangana, the peasant movement was a failure. Now, last but not the least, comes the Tibhaga movement in Bengal. The word Tibhaga literally means three shares of the harvest. The crop sharing system known as Barga, Adi, Bagi, and etc. The sharecroppers used to give 50% share of the produce on their tenancy. But the sharecropper wanted the 2/3 for themselves and 1/3 for the landlords. And this clash gave birth to the Tibhaga movement. These sharecroppers challenged the custom of sharing crops. During the harvest of 1946, they went to the fields and cut down the crops and threshed them on their own. Because they were thinking that the landowners are the only investors and do no hard work whatsoever, whereas the tenants made most of the labor. Even the tenants took the stand that the stock of the harvest would be stored at the tenants' compound and the landlord would not be getting any shares from the byproducts of the grains. The movement spread across 19 districts of Bengal. The landlords refused their demands and called the police. Many of them were put behind the bars. Now, this made the tenants more furious. And in few places of the Tibhaga movement, the peasants declared their zones as Tibhaga areas. As a result of this, many landlords were ready to accept the demands of the tenants. In addition to that, in early 1947, such developments led government to introduce a bill in the Legislative Assembly. But unfortunately, the government could not enact the bill into law. Overall, the Tibhaga movement was, as it has been, estimated that 40% of the sharecropping peasants were granted the Tibhaga right by the landlords themselves. The East Bengal State Acquisition and the Tenancy Act of 1950 was passed due to the initiation of this movement. Now, we are moving towards the labor movements. The labor movement or laborism is the term generally used for the organization of the working people developed to represent and campaign for the better working conditions, treatment from the employers, and employment laws. Now, according to the labor historians, the span of the labor movements in India is divided into four distinct phases. The first phase was from 1850 to 1890, and the second phase was from 1890 to 1918. The third phase was from 1918 to 1947, and the final phase is post-independence period. Now, it is important to go through these struggles because these were the reasons for the labor movements in the pre-independence period. The major labor struggles in 1920s were the Madras tramway workers in 1400 due to the wages, more than 10,000 railway workers in Jamalpur also because of the wages, about 5,000 workers of express mill in Nagpur due to the wages, more than 20,000 cotton textiles, tannery and other workers in Kanpur, and this movement was because of the wages and also for the working hours. 10,000 masons in Calcutta, also due to the wages. 67,000 jute mills workers in Howrah, also because of the wages. 4,000 dock workers in Bombay, also because of the wages. About 14,000 textile workers in Solapur Iron due to the less wages. And the ninth, about 5,000 copper workers in Ahmedabad, and this movement was also because of the wages and also due to bonus. And the tenth, the last, was more than 2.35 lakhs textile workers in Bombay, and this movement was caused because of the allowance and the working hours. Now, after independence, there was a great expansion in the modern manufacturing industries in various sectors because of the public sector utilities, corporations and government offices. Now, generally, the workers employed in the public sector enjoy better working conditions than those who are employed in the private sector. But soon the situation started to change. There was all chaos in the case of workers. So, the labor movement entered into a different phase. As I've said, that after independence, many new industries came into existence. It was a new atmosphere for the workers, and the number of conflicts between the workers and the employers reduced between 1947 and 1960. But unfortunately, it didn't continue for a long time, and the situation started changing. The period from 1960s to 1970s were years of inflation. The wages given to the employers decreased. So, it was obvious that there would be disputes between the worker and the employers. There were 2,151 disputes found in the single year in 1964. Looking at the period from 1960s, it was a period of political turmoil which affected and shaped the labor movement. There was an establishment of trade unions that were to be dominated by parties. The number of national unions in the countries multiplied. Till the laborers who were working in the private sector were struggling for their rights, in addition to that, those who were working in the public sector, they also joined them, because they were hit directly by the centralized bureaucratic state apparatus. As the movement got support of the labor from both the sectors, that is the private sector and the public sector, it became powerful. The most important strike that took place was the strike of 1974, which till date remains the most serious of all the direct working class actions in the country. Talking about the laborers from the private sectors, they had to face a lot of hardships because a large percentage of work days being lost. In 1980s, the number of loss of work days increased and continued during 1985, 1987 and 1988, the work days lost in lockouts. Obviously, this lockout had adversely affected the industrial laborers, and they came to the stage of unemployment. Many small industrial units got sick. Even many started to move toward closures. Thus, the working class was hit hard in 1980s by lockouts, closures and sickness. It is not that the present developing India is not facing the same problem, but the problem of lockout has continued even today and is considered a serious problem. According to the Labour Bureau, there were 387 lockouts in the year 1999. In 2000, the number was 345. And in the year 2001, there were 302 lockouts observed. Maharashtra, West Bengal, Uttar Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Bihar and Kerala, these six states account for the 70% of the trade, and the growth of unionization is uneven in different industries. Now, the number of trade unions has been steadily increasing in the country. So, the trade union movement has become a major movement in India today. Now, let's come to the conclusion. Through its history of more than 100 years of struggle, the peasants and the laborers have acquired important economic and political gains. Though they have acquired significant economic gains, these gains have been lost due to the continuous increase in the prices of basic commodities. So, there will be the same picture in the future too. The future will repeat the history of the past struggles. Definitely, the problems, the peasants, the laborers, the activists, and the titles of the movements will be different. But the situation created by them will be more or less the same. So, a better solution on this is remembering the history of the movements and not to repeat the same mistakes of inhuman and unjust of the working conditions and wages. Thank you.